for Watson.
Hear, hear.
Thanks, Deputy Speaker. What sort of government attacks workers in the middle of a pandemic? Because what's in front of us now is nothing more than an attack on people who work in creative industries. Let's not gloss over. This is not like what we were dealing with when we were arguing they needed to redesign JobKeeper to make sure people who were actors and creatives got access to it. This is not negligence on the government's part. What's in front of us right now is a direct attack to halve the contribution to Australian drama from Foxtel. That's what's in front of us.
It's shameful.
So if you're working in television, if you're working in scripted drama, whether you're an actor, whether you're a scriptwriter, whether you're a producer, whether you hold the camera, whether you're a makeup artist, whether you're one of the many people employed in this area, have a think about the number of attacks that are on from this government right now. First of all, you've got the lack of protection in terms of support during the pandemic itself. And we've canvassed that many times in this chamber. But then you have direct attacks from this government. They chose now to reduce the obligation on free-to-air television for scripted drama. Now, during a pandemic, when people are already out of work, when people are already struggling to make a living, they decide now is a really good time to say to free-to-air TV, oh, you don't have to do as much scripted drama as you used to. Like, of all the times, wait until an industry's on its knees and then say, oh, now's a good time to attack them. So they do that for free-to-air TV. They do that in cuts to the ABC. And then they use the fact that these cuts have been made to say, oh, now Foxtel's at a competitive disadvantage. We need to reduce their obligation. Now, I've got to say, our opposition to this bill is not a criticism of Foxtel in any way, shape or form, because I will say Foxtel have been a good citizen when it comes to Australian drama for their whole history. Productions like Love My Way, starring Claudia Carve and Asher Keddie, Dan Wiley, really showed Australians doing the kind of complex, long-form drama which the Americans had pioneered with shows like The Sopranos and Six Feet Under. The Kettering Incident, unsettling, brilliant horror drama set in Tasmania. Wentworth, gritty Australian drama inside a women's prison. Actors like Pamela Rabe, Danielle Cormack, Susie Porter, and this year Marta Dusseldorp joining the cast. Good drama coming from Foxtel. And what's the government's response? We'll cut it in half. You think that doesn't mean jobs? You think that doesn't make a difference to all the small businesses that proliferate in this industry? And all of this in the context of a change that needed to be made that the government has refused to make. Because there is a competitive disadvantage that Foxtel is in at the moment. There is, in fact, a competitive disadvantage that free-to-air TV is in as well at the moment. And it's a competitive disadvantage that should have been fixed 8 long years ago. Yep. And it's this. The streaming companies have come through with absolutely no requirement for Australian content. Absolutely no requirement. And so when free-to-air, and Australian content is more expensive, we get that. But it will always be so for a very simple reason. We are a population where predominantly English is the first language of most of the country. That means when you produce drama in this country, you are competing for stories with all the other English-speaking countries of the world, many of them with a population base way in excess of ours. So we have a competitive disadvantage when it comes to scripted drama, and quotas are the only way you can make sure that Australian stories will be told. And so that's why we have quotas. That's why the Foxtel scripted drama rule was put in place. That's why we need to have a system put in place for the streaming services. And every year of inaction makes it harder to do this. Why is it getting harder now? Because in the face of complete inaction from the government, some of the free-to-airs have now gone to their own streaming services. So now they're in both camps which means there will be a level of resistance that would not have been there 8 years ago if the action had been taken at the start. But the inaction from this government is the reason we are in this mess now. And what's the government's solution to an inequity? What's the government's solution when they say, oh, well, Foxtel's now at a competitive disadvantage to the free-to-airs where we've cut their drama quotas? The solution is, oh, well, let's keep the race to the bottom going. And let's make the cuts apply to Foxtel as well. So when we started with a situation where Foxtel had good obligations and free-to-air had good obligations, but there were no obligations for scripted drama on the streaming services, the government's approach, instead of having the guts and the policy and the intellect to do something about raising streaming services' obligations to provide Australian content, their answer was, well, let's just lower everything else. And what's in front of us now? Let's not pretend this will be the end of the story. Because as long as there is no obligation for Australian drama on the streaming services, the objective of this government will be to lower and lower and lower the obligations. What we see today will be the beginning of a continued process of taking away obligations on free-to-air TV, on taking away obligations on Foxtel. And the outcome will be simple. The outcome will be simple. And I hear the minister say, oh, that's a small blessing. I hear the minister refer to the fact of, oh, his colleague gets to leave and he's stuck here. Well, it's about time he listened to what's happening in the sector, because in a moment he's going to vote. He's going to vote to cut the contribution to Australian drama in half. You reckon that doesn't affect half the jobs? You reckon that doesn't affect half the businesses? Of course it does. But let's not pretend that the government sort of stumbled into this. This is eyes wide open. This is a deliberate strategy of not caring about Australian stories being told. So, as I say, we don't criticise Foxtel. Foxtel have been a good player. But there is a way of delivering a fair playing field here. And it's to look at the section which has no obligations and to put obligations in that area. The reason, and get back to the first principles of it all. Why do we have quotas in the first place? We have them because there is a belief that seeing our stories on screen matters.
Because it does.
That Australians should be able to watch stories that are set in their own country. That they should be able to watch stories where the accents and the voices and the language that they hear from the screen are the same as what they hear in their community. And not every one of these productions is going to be commercial without quotas, is going to be commercial without funding obligations. And that's okay, because the alternative is we end up in a situation where we only judge success in scripted drama by whether it ends up being the big profit-making activity. And I don't want us to continue to be in the world that we were in 20 years ago, when you can have a show like The Man from Snowy River, but Kirk Douglas has to be one of the main actors in it. That the only way you can tell an Australian story is if you get the foreign buy-in, because then you can legitimise and turn the thing into a commercial success overseas. If a show only talks to our own people, it is still a story worth telling. It is still a story worth telling. Most people here would have watched Secret City, set in this building, a partnership with Foxtel. And the people who got work for that weren't just the actors on the screen. The soundtrack for that show, music by David Bridie. Some of you would know him from My Friend the Chocolate Cake. You'd know him as a serious composer. The work of a whole lot of creatives is delivered by quotas. That's where it comes from. The Devil's Playground, one of the iconic Australian stories, had a complete long-form drama on Foxtel with the actor Simon Burke, who actually played the child in the original movie. Not related to me. Played the child in the original movie, then playing the same character years later with a new Australian story. speaking so directly to a whole lot of the stories of abuse that came out of the Royal Commission. These stories don't get told because they're automatically commercially viable. They get told because there is a guarantee of investment. And there is no way of looking at this bill other than to say, for one of the good corporate citizens, Foxtel, that obligation gets cut in half. Because when you move from 10 to 5, that's half. There is no other way of looking at this. It is an appalling decision. And it's no wonder they took the title of arts out of the name of the department. It's no wonder that we've been for 8 years without Australia having a cultural policy. Because for all of this time, I mean, George Brandis, a lot of criticisms of him, at least he wanted the portfolio. Since then, we've had people who say, yes, get it because it's lumped in with something else. And no commitment to making sure that our stories are told. Now, this bill is part of the race to the bottom. Let's not pretend that what was done under the cover of the pandemic with free-to-air TV will be the last thing that this government does with respect to Australian content quotas. But what they've already done in terms of, does that hit scripted drama? You bet it does. And does this hit scripted drama? Yeah, it cuts it in half. In half for the obligation on Foxtel. And all the while, a government that seems very happy to be asleep at the wheel does nothing on streaming services. So I want Foxtel to be on a level playing field. And the way to do that is for the streaming services to have an obligation as well. It is a ridiculous situation at the moment. If you use a smart TV and you go through Binge or through one of the Foxtel apps or through Foxtel itself on a cable connection, there is an Australian content obligation. But if on the same TV you shift your remote control to a different icon, suddenly there's no Australian obligation. Because the relationship, the reason that we have quotas, is not because we're obsessed with the measure of bandwidth and how something comes to our home, whether it comes by a Foxtel cable or whether it comes through the sky, or whether it and we don't care if it comes through an internet connection. It's because we care about our stories going from the screen to whoever's sitting on the lounge. And if the government believes that those stories should be cut in half, have the guts to explain why. Front the small businesses that rely on these quotas and tell them that you think they should only have half the profit or only half the company should be there. Because this government understands jobs in film when it's a Hollywood production. This government understands that you get a whole lot of extra businesses involved if it's a Hollywood story being told on the Gold Coast or being told at Fox Studios. And we have supported those processes and those policies because of the jobs that they create. But Australian stories create jobs too. And how on earth does a government get it into its head that it will put taxpayers' dollars behind the jobs that come from the telling of American stories, and in the same year, during the same pandemic, at the same time the sector's being smashed, decide it's time to cut the obligations on Australian stories being told? Now, maybe they just like that when they go to a Hollywood set, they get photographed with people who are more famous around the globe, and that makes them, it makes a better Instagram pic. I don't know. But I'll tell you what, it means nothing to people who want to see their stories be told. Absolutely. It means nothing to people who want to have an opportunity that when you turn on a television in Australia, you've got a decent chance of the story being an Australian story. Yeah, and please never come back with some jingoistic pride in the country when, as a government, you have made deliberate decisions to cut the telling of Australian stories in half. Yeah.